of might and strength. Who? Allah. So whenever in this life, in dunya, matters seem like they are difficult, or it seems like that you are going to be overpowered, or it seems like that you're going to be overcome by someone or something, know that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is Al-Aziz. This person that you fear, Allah is more powerful, more mighty than him. Turn to Allah, and Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala grant you. What did Nuh alayhi salam said? He said, Inni maghloobun fantasir. I'm being overpowered. These people, they're more in number than me. And what did he say? Fantasir, grant me victory. Assist me, aid me. That is how the individual is. He says, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. There is no might and strength except with Allah. Huh? What does that mean? That I possess no might and strength? It's all from Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Notice something. When do you say this every day? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. There's a time specific that you meant to say it. When is that? Huh? In the adhan, when the muaddin says what? Hayya ala salah and? Hayya ala falah. You respond by saying hayya ala falah, right? La, you say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Why? Why is that? He's talking about salah. He's telling you, come to the prayer, come to success. Huh? Success is from Allah, but it's more than that. You're saying la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. There's no might and strength except with Allah. Na'am, no man. Of course. But when the muaddin is coming, telling you to come and calling you, what are you doing? You're coming to the prayer, isn't it? You're responding to the call. When you're responding to the call, who granted the ability to respond to the call? Allah. That ability that you were granted in order to respond to that call and to come to the salah and to walk towards it and to respond to the call of success, it is Allah that granted that strength. It is Allah that allowed you to do so. That power is from Allah Azza wa Jalla. You attribute it to Allah, not yourself. Meaning that you never ever deluded by what you do. Even the righteous deeds that you do, you never tell yourself, wow, I've accomplished this. Rather, it's Allah that's allowed you to do that. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. كنز من كنوز الجنة. It's a treasure from the treasures of paradise when you say لا إله لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. جميل. That's the effect these names are meant to have. That was just one example. And the examples are many with each name. Many examples, right? But we're going to, inshallah ta'ala, continue from the 29th name that we got up to, inshallah azza wa jal, which is Al-Ghani. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Al-Ghani. Al-Ghani, Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran, Ya ayyuhal nasu antumul fuqara'u ila Allah. Wallahu huwal ghaniyyul hamid. إن يشأ يذهبكم ويأتي بخلق جديد وما ذلك على الله بعزيز. O mankind, Allah says, أنتم الفقراء إلى الله. You are those who are in dire need of Allah. You are in need of Allah. والله أن الله عز وجل is الغني, the most rich, and the one who is in need of nothing and no one. That's what Al-Ghani means. That Allah is the most rich, has everything, possesses everything, Jalla fi ula, and is not in need of anything or anyone. Al-Hamid, the one who is praised. إِنْ يَشَاءْ يُذْهِبُكُمْ. If Allah wishes, He will get rid of you, Allah says. وَيَأْتِ بِخَلْقٍ جَدِيدٍ. And He will bring a new creation. Meaning that Allah is not in need of us. He's not in need of our ibadah. He's not in need of our dua. He's not in need of anything that we do. If He wishes, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He will place us with a whole new creation. وَمَا ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ بِعَزِيزٍ. And that is not difficult for Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Al-Ghani, in a nutshell, linguistically, it means the one who is not in need of anyone. Right? It means the one who is not in need of anyone. That's what Al-Ghani means. But religiously, what does it mean? What is being referred to when we are saying Al-Ghani? It means that there's no one who's richer than Allah. Absolutely no one who's richer than Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. And everyone is poor and in need of Allah. Everyone, everything. So Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, He's rich in His essence. And He's rich in His actions. And He's rich in His attributes. And He's rich in His authority and power, Jalla fi Ula. And from the perfection of His richness, it is that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, our obedience, it does not benefit Him. There's no benefit that Allah gets from anyone or anything. Rather, He is the one who benefits us. Benefit and harm only comes from Allah. And that's why if we believe that benefit and harm comes from anything else other than Allah, that is shirk. Isn't it? It is shirk that one believes that benefit and harm comes from other than Allah, Jalla fi'ula. If I believe an item is going to benefit me, I believe that benefit comes from that item itself, that is shirk. But if I believe that that item is a means of benefit, but Allah ultimately benefit comes from, that's fine. Right? And the opposite is the same. If I believe a certain item is going to protect me from harm, I believe it is going to protect me from harm, then that's shirk. But if I believe something that Allah has legislated is going to protect him from harm, but ultimately it's Allah who protects from harm, but it is just a means, that is fine. For instance, certain people, they hang up certain eyes in their houses or their properties and so on, right? A blue eye. Why do they do it? They believe that it protects them from what? Evil eye, right? Is that allowed? Why not? They're relying on the blue eye. So they believe that it protects them. If they believe that it is just a means of protection and Allah ultimately is protecting them through that, that is minor shirk. That is minor shirk. And that's what the majority of people believe anyway. Because if you believe something that Allah has not legislated to be a form of protection, it is shirk asghar, minor shirk. What does shirk asghar do, minor shirk? What's the consequence of it? It nullifies your deeds. It makes your deeds void. If they were to believe that blue eye is a form of protection itself, that protection comes from it, it's not a means anymore, that is shirk akbar. That is major shirk. Right? Does that make sense? Tayyib. So benefit and harm only comes from Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, from His ghina, His richness, it is that huwa muhsinun ila ibadihi, that He is one who is kind and generous with His slaves. Right? Whilst that He's not in need of them, He gives them all of khair, goodness. He protects them from harm. He is the one who bestows upon them His blessings, Jalla fi'ula. Now if we look at the creation, those who are rich, they may give you something, but why? Because perhaps they want something in return. Either that people praise them for their generosity and their kindness, or that they get something back from you, or that they are employing you, or whatever. But Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, He grants us from His ultimate jood, His generosity, and with His ghina, His richness, without any benefit coming from us towards Him. We can't benefit Allah in any way. Also, from the perfection of Allah's richness, it is that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala did not take a son or a wife or any partner in His kingdom, Jalla fi'ula, because that shows need, doesn't it? If you have a son, why do we have children? One of the objectives of having children is that they make dua for us after we pass away, that they are our, yani they benefit us in this world and the hereafter. They take care of us when we get older. All of that, right? Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala does not have a son. That's why when they attribute to Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala a son, the Christians and others, right? They are insulting Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala and saying that Allah Azza wa Jalla is not Al-Ghani. And that's why Allah says in the Quran, وَقَالُوا اتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ وَلَدًا سُبْحَانَهُ هُوَ الْغَنِي. He says, they say that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala has taken a son. Subhana, exalted is Allah. Then Allah says, Huwa al-Ghani, he's the most rich. Meaning he's not in need of anything or anyone. Why would Allah need a son? The Christians say that Isa alayhi salam is the son of Allah because he does not have a father. Tayyib, Allah says in the Quran, Inna mathala Isa inda Allahi kamathali Adam. The example of Isa alayhi salam in the sight of Allah Azza, just like the one of Adam alayhi salam. Khalaqahu min turab, Allah created Adam from dust, and then he said, Kun fayakun bi, and it was. Adam had no father and mother. Isa had a mother. Yani, if you want to say that someone is, yani, ta'ala Allah an dalik, if Allah was taking a son, Adam would have been that. Yani, Allah is logically speaking to the individual that what he was saying does not make sense. Adam had no father, no mother. Where Isa alayhi salam had a mother. But Allah Tabaraka negated all that from himself, Jalla fi ula. But Allah Azza wa Jalla gives these logical arguments in the Quran so that these people can understand that what they are saying makes absolutely no sense. But Allah is Halim, yani, which is going to come up on the name Al Halim. What does Halim mean? Huh? Forbearing. Allah Azza wa Jalla is forbearing. They insult Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, Allah's forbearing. They attribute to Allah that which is not true, alaykum salam. And Allah Azza wa Jalla is forbearing. He does not punish them immediately. Jalla fi ula. Tayyib. In the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jalla, He mentions certain names together with Ghani. He says in the Quran, Wallahu ghaniyun halim, that Allah Azza wa Jalla is Ghani, the most rich, who is not in need of anyone or anything. Halim, the most forbearing. Right? And notice here that Allah Azza wa Jalla, He mentions he's forbearing with His richness. What do we benefit from that? That Allah Azza wa Jalla, number one, those who attribute to Him that which is not true, which negates His richness, Allah's forbearing with them, meaning He doesn't punish them immediately. Secondly, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, He is Ghani and Halim. He's the most rich and Halim, forbearing. Meaning that when the creation, they give charity, right? And then they remind those they gave charity to that I have done this for you, I have given this to you, and so on. They do man, right? Which makes your charity void, the reward of it. Allah Tabaraka wa Halim is forbearing with that. He does not punish them immediately for that. Because they're harming others by what those statements saying that I have given you this and that and that. Allah says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, la tubtilu sadaqatikum bil manni wal adha. O you who believe, do not invalidate and ruin your sadaqat, your charity, bi al manni wal adha. Man, it is mentioning your favors, the favor that you've done for others to them, reminding them, I've done this and this, I've given you this. Wal adha and harm. It's a form of harm. Naam. Also in the Quran, Allah mentions that al ghani is partnered with another name. Another attribute of Allah Azza wa Jalla, وَرَبُّكَ الْغَنِيُّ ذُو الرَّحْمَةِ, and your Lord is Al-Ghani, the most rich. ذُو الرَّحْمَةِ, the one who possesses mercy. He mentioned جَلَّ فِي عُلَى, His mercy with His richness. And what do we benefit from that? We benefit from that, that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, He is the one who is not in need of His slaves and their worship and their obedience and their righteous deeds. But despite that, from His mercy, He grants them all of goodness and that which benefits them in this world and the hereafter, and He protects them from all of harm in this world and the hereafter. Yani, His richness did not stop Him from bestowing His blessings and bounties upon them. Whereas the creation, when they're not in need of anyone, what happens? They completely abandon everyone, don't they? Allah Azza wa Jal, He's not in need of anyone, but He bestows His mercy upon us and gives us and gives us and gives us and does not neglect us. Jalla fi ula. And Allah Azza wa Jal, He mentioned another ayah where Ghani is part of another name. Allah says, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ حَمِيدٌ. And know that Allah is Ghaniyun, the most rich, Hamid, the one who's praised, deserving of praise, all of praise and gratitude with love is for Allah Jalla Fi'ula. His partner was Hamid. What do we benefit from that? We benefit from that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, His ghina, His richness, it is that He bestows all the blessings upon us, and that is what requires that we praise Him for it. And if we do not praise Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala for it, Allah Azza wa Jal, the rest of His creation, they do that anyway. He's not in need of us doing it. Subhanah. And that's why He said in the ayah before that I mentioned in the beginning, Ya ayyuha an-nas antumul fuqara'u ila Allah wallahu huwal ghaniyyul hamid. O mankind, you are those who are in dire need of Allah. And Allah Azza wa Jal is ghani, the one who is the most rich, not in need of anyone. Hamid, the one who's praised. The one who's praised is mentioning with that at the end of that ayah, meaning that Allah, you're in dire need of His blessings and His mercy and His aid and His assistance and His protection and so on. It is Allah who's praised for that, who is not in need. Right? You praise Allah for all those things that you're in need of. That's what is directing us to do. طيب. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he narrates to us in hadith. حديث قدسي أتى الله تبارك وتعالى he says يا عبادي لو أن أولكم وآخركم وإنسكم وجنكم قاموا في صعيد واحد فسألوني فأعطيت كل واحد مسألته ما نقص ذلك مما عندي إلا كما ينقص المخيط إذا أدخل البحر. Allah says, oh my slaves, if the first of creation and the last of the creation and all of jinkind and mankind, they stood in one place and every single one of them, they asked Allah. And then Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala granted every single one of them what they requested. Allah says, that will not decrease from what I have, just like the needle, when it's placed or put in the sea and the ocean, it is not affected at all. When you put a needle in the sea, what does it do to it? Does it affect it anyway? Does it decrease the water in any way? That's the same with Allah, what Allah has. When Allah grants every single one of us what we request, every single one of the creation, it does not decrease Allah Azza wa Jalla what He has, just like the needle. What it the needle decreases from the sea. And no effect. That is the ghina of Allah. What is the effect that this name is meant to have upon us? Al-Ghani. What is the effect that this name is meant to have upon us? The Prophet alayhi salatu narrates in hadith, hadith Qudsi, that Allah says, Allah is directing us exactly what to do when we know that He is Al-Ghani. The hadith says, يا ابن آدم تفرغ لعبادتي أملأ صدرك غنى وأسد فقرك. الله عز وجل says, O son of Adam, preoccupy yourself and make yourself free لعبادتي for my worship. What's the outcome? أملأ صدرك غنى. I will fill your heart and your chest with richness. وَأَسُدُّ فَقْرَكَ, and I will get rid of your poverty. Through what? Through ibadah. When you know that Allah Azza is al-ghani, rizq that you're seeking, provision, it comes through ibadah. What does Allah say? فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيُمْدِدُكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا. A man came to Al-Hasan al-Basri, rahimahullah, the great imam of the tabi'een. And he asked me, Ya Imam, where I'm living, there's no rain, there's a drought. Advise me, what should I do? He told him, seek forgiveness from Allah. Another man came and said, Ya Imam, I'm very poor,
I'm in a state of poverty. Advise me, what should I do? He said, seek forgiveness from Allah. Another one came, he said, Ya Imam, I've been married for so long and I have no children. Allah has not granted me any offspring. Advise me, what should I do? He said, seek forgiveness from Allah. Those around him, they observed this incident. And they said to him, Ya Aba Sa'id, these three men, they came to you asking you three different matters and you gave them the exact same answer. Why is that? He said, Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran that Nuh alayhi salam, he said to his people, O my people, seek forgiveness from Allah. Verily Allah is ghaffar, the most forgiving. What will happen if you seek forgiveness? Yursili sama'a alaykum midrara. Allah will send beneficial rain upon you. A lot of rain. وَيُمْدِدُكُمْ بِأَمْوَالِ وَبَنِينَ And he will grant you amwal, wealth, وَبَنِينَ and offspring. وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتِ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارَ And he will grant you jannat, gardens and rivers. Through what? Istighfar, ibadah. When the individual is attached to Allah Azza wa Jal and he seeks all of goodness from Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah grants him. In the hadith, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he tells us, whoever makes the dunya his concern, all he's worried about dunya, worldly matters. فرق الله أمره. Allah will scatter his affairs. وجعل الفقر بين عينيه. And Allah will place poverty between his eyes. All he sees is poverty. ولم يأته من الدنيا إلا ما كتب له. And he shall not get from the dunya except that which is recorded for him. What does that mean? That only that which is recorded for him he'll get, no more. But look at the opposite. Whoever makes the akhirah his concern, the hadith says, جَمَعَ اللَّهُ لَهُ أَمْرَهُ Allah will gather his affairs for him, meaning Allah will take care of his affairs for him. وَجَعَلَ غِنَاهُ فِي صَدْرِهِ And Allah will place richness in his heart. Even if he doesn't have much, he feels like he has the most. غِنَا is the غِنَا الْقَلْبِ, is that of the heart, the richness of the heart. وَأَتَتْهُ الدُّنْيَا وَهِيَ رَاغِمَةٌ And the dunya will come to him unwillingly, without him seeking it. The dunya will follow him. He doesn't chase it, it chases him. That's the one who makes the dunya not a priority. The akhirah is a priority. Dunya is secondary. That is the outcome. طيب. That is Al-Ghani. The next name. We have the 30th name. We have Al-Hakim. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says in the Quran, إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ إِن تُعَذِّبُهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ عِبَادُكَ وَإِن تَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ Allah says, if you punish them, Ya Allah, then they are your slaves. Isa alayhi salam is saying this. Allah narrates it in Surah Al-Ma'idah. That he says, Ya Allah, if you punish them, then they are your slaves. And if you forgive them, you are Al-Aziz, the Almighty, Al-Hakim, the All-Wise. Al-Hakim, what does it mean? Linguistically, it is Al-Hakim. It is an exaggerated noun in Arabic language. It means that, it has numerous meanings. It means the one who has knowledge of all matters, number one. The one who possesses knowledge of everything. And it means the one who has the ultimate wisdom. That's the first meaning. The second meaning it is that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala Al-Hakim is the one who judges between the people and his judgment is final. That's the second meaning of Al-Hakim. The third meaning, Al-Hakim, it is the one who perfects all matters. He does all matters with perfection. That's the third meaning. And he does all matters with perfection and he puts everything in his suitable place. And the fourth meaning of Al-Hakim, it is that the one who does not do anything that is not suitable. He does not do anything that is inappropriate. Right? All those meanings are different linguistic meanings of Al-Hakim, linguistically. But what does it mean religiously? Religious meaning of Al-Hakim. It means that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He is Al-Hakim fi Aqwali, He is the most wise in His statements, and the most wise in His actions, and the most wise in His judgments and rulings. All that occurs from the wisdom of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. So He does not do anything or say anything or judge except with that which is the truth and just and correct. That's what it means. And it also means that the actions of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala have no faults. They have no faults. Al-Hakim. Everything happens with perfection. And it also means that له الحكم في الأولى والآخرة. To Him belongs the judgment in this world and the hereafter. It's one of the means of Al-Hakim. Like Allah says in Surah Qasas, وَهُوَ اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ لَهُ الْحَمْدُ فِي الْأُولَى وَالْآخِرَةِ وَلَهُ الْحُكْمُ وَإِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. That He is Allah, لا إله إلا هو. There is no deity worthy of worship except Him. لَهُ الْحَمْدُ, for Him, to Him belongs praise in this world and the hereafter. وَلَهُ الْحُكْمُ, unto Him is the judgment in this world and the hereafter, and to Him you shall return. طيب. Allah mentions in the Quran this name Hakim paired up with other names. Number one, the most common one that's in the Quran, it is Wallahu Azizul Hakim. That Allah is the Almighty, the All-Wise. That comes up in the Quran 46 times. 46 times Allah mentions in the Quran Wallahu Azizul Hakim. Right? And there's a reason for that. Because the Izzah, might, it necessitates that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He does some things with power and strength, Jalla fi ula, but that's out of His wisdom. That power and strength, it is used, and force is used, Jalla fi ula. And I'll give you an example of that. There was a scholar who was a scholar of the Arabic language. His name was Al-Asma'i, very famous. One day he was teaching in the masjid, and as he was teaching, what happened? He was teaching the people, and then he recited the ayah that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He talks about the thief and the ruling of the thief, when Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ فَاقْطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا. The male thief and the female thief, cut off their hands, جَزَاءً بِمَا كَسَبَا نَكَالًا مِنَ اللَّهِ, as a reward for what they have done, and a punishment from Allah. And then Asma'i, he ended the ayah by saying, Wallahu ghafurur rahim. And Allah Azza is the most forgiving and the most merciful. When he recited the ayah, a Bedouin was sitting there. Bedouins are normally people who are not educated when it comes to Quran and stuff like that. But they are very eloquent when it comes to the Arabic language, the Bedouins. So this Bedouin, he heard Al-Asma'i recite the ayah, وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ فَقَطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا جَزَاءً بِمَا كَسَبَا نَكَالًا مِنَ اللَّهِ. And then Asma'i said, وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. And then the Arabi, he got up, he said, لا, وَاللَّهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. It is وَاللَّهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. Asma'i, you got it wrong. The Arabi doesn't know the Quran, by the way. Yeah, but he corrected Asma'i and told him, it's Wallahu Azizul Hakim, it's Allah the Almighty, the All-Wise. Asma'i said to him, how comes the Bedouin? He said, because this is Makan Izzah, Allah's punishing them, showing His might by cutting off their hand for stealing. And He is the All-Wise because this ruling in it is wisdom to protect and stop others from stealing. They are made example of. It is not a place of forgiveness. Ar-Rahma, Ya Asma'i said to him. And the Bedouin was right. It's Wallahu Azizul Hakim. Right. So the understanding of the Quran, it even helps you to know how to end the ayat correctly. Which names are suitable for the ayat. The Bedouin who didn't know Quran, because his knowledge of the Arabic language, he knew how to end the ayat. Asma'i, by the way, is a scholar of Arabic language too. But the Bedouin knew what was correct there. Right, and everyone's human, everyone makes mistakes. طيب. We have in the Quran that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala also says in the ayah of Ma'idah, إِن تُعَذِّبُهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ عِبَادُكَ وَإِن تَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. If you punish them, Ya Allah, then they are your slaves. And if you forgive them, you are Al-Aziz Al-Hakim, the Almighty and the All-Wise. Again, Allah Azza wa Jalla ended the ayah with Al-Aziz Al-Hakim, because the ayahs took up punishment. And the punishment, it shows the izzah of Allah, the might and the power of Allah Ta'ala, and the hikmah of Allah. The hikmah of Allah, it necessitates that Allah, He may punish certain individuals and He may forgive others based on His wisdom, Jalla fi'ula. And no one will ever question the wisdom of Allah and the judgment of Allah Yawm al-Qiyamah, because it is the fairest. Rather, they will praise Allah for His judgment. وَقِيلَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah says that when the judgment is done, Yawm al-Qiyamah, all of the creation are going to praise Him. Even those who are in the hellfire, they will praise Allah, because they know that they're deserving of this punishment, that it is fair. الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, they say. Right? عِزَّة. Now, what is the Jalal of this name, the grandeur of this name? When we know that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is Al-Hakim, the All-Wise, and the one who has the perfect judgment, and the one who does the perfect actions, and everything in the best manner, right? It should remind the slave of Allah Jalla fi'ula that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, everything that occurs in this world, it happens from His wisdom. We may understand that wisdom and we may not comprehend it. And a lot of the time we do not comprehend it. But the believer, he submits without questioning it if he does not comprehend it, because our minds are not made to comprehend everything. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, His actions are above that. And the effect it is meant to have upon you, this name, it is that you are meant to seek the hikmah wherever it is. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is telling you that He is Al-Hakim, the most wise, the all wise. It also teaches us that we need to be those who seek wisdom from the places that wisdom is. And Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He tells us the places of wisdom in the Quran. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He says, يُؤْتِ الْحِكْمَةَ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَمَنْ يُؤْتَ الْحِكْمَةَ فَقَدْ أُوْتِيَ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. That He grants wisdom to whoever He wishes. And whoever's granted wisdom, then He's granted a lot of khayr, a lot of goodness. What is wisdom here? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and others, they say it is the wisdom here, it is knowing the Quran. So where does one seek wisdom from? Kitabullah tabarak wa ta'ala. Right? Knowing the nasikh wal mansukh, muhkamihi wa mutashabihihi. Right? Halaluhu wa haramuhu wa amthaluhu wa ghayr dhalik. Knowing the nasikh wal mansukh, the abrogator and that which is abrogated. Do you guys know what that means? The abrogator and that which abrogates. Well, that which was abrogated, I mean. What does that mean in the Quran? That which abrogates and that which was abrogated. They were so what does abrogation mean? That's what you want to know. So what does it do? So the previous one cancels, yani, cancelled out. Abrogation in the Quran is three types. An-naskhu fil Quran is three types. Allah mentioned Surah Al-Baqarah, مَا نَنْسَخْ مِنْ آيَةٍ أَوْ نُنْسِهَا نَأْتِي بِخَيْرِ مِنْهَا أَوْ مِثْلِهَا. Allah says, we do not abrogate an ayah in the Quran or make it forget it, except that we bring better than it or something like it. So abrogation, it is three types. Number one, it is that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He abrogates an ayah by completely making everyone forget it. Taking out the Quran, everyone's made to forget it as if it never existed. That's one of the type of abrogation the Prophet Ali he mentioned. Ayah affirmed the zone. Nun siha, Allah says, we made it forgotten. An ayah was in the Quran, Allah abrogated it, meaning that it is no longer part of the Quran, and the ruling is no longer part of the Quran. Allah makes it completely forgotten, everyone forgets it. The Sahaba who knew it, they forgot it. The Prophet Ali said, we made to forget it. That's the first type of abrogation, okay? Which was happening in the time of the Prophet Ali. No abrogation happens now, by the way. It will happen time of khalas. The Quran is complete. No one can come and say, I don't like this ayah, I'm going to abrogate it. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. That's the first type of abrogation. Second type of abrogation, it is that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He abrogates an ayah by taking it out of the Quran, but the ruling still applies. An example of that is the ruling of stoning. Stoning for adultery, right? The ruling is applied, but the ayah was taken out. Okay, the ayah, it goes something like this. It was a sheikh wa sheikhatu idha zanaya. I can't remember the rest of it. It's not Quran, yani. The old man and old woman, if they fornicate and commit adultery, then they should be stoned, right? It was in the Quran, it was taken out, the ruling still applies. That's the second type of abrogation. The third type of abrogation, an-naskh, it is that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, He reveals an ayah later which abrogates the ruling in a previous ayah, and they are both in the Quran. We find that in the Quran, when we look at the prohibition of alcohol, you mentioned the example, right? The prohibition of alcohol. It went through three stages. The first ayah, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala said that, يسألونك عن الخمر والميسر. They ask you about khamr and maysir, gambling. Then Allah said, in them it is evil and benefit for man, but their evil outweighs their benefit. That's the first stage. The second stage was, Allah said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقْرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى حَتَّى تَعْلَمُوا مَا تَقُولُ. Allah says, oh you believe, do not come near the prayer whilst you're intoxicated until you know that which you are saying, you're uttering. So what's the prohibition now? It's saying, you can drink, but don't drink when you go into salah. That was the second stage. That ayah is in the Quran. Then the third stage was, Allah says in Surah Ma'idah that al-khamr wal-maysir, all of these matters, fajtanibu, it is rijzum min amal shaytan, fajtanibu. It's from the action of shaytan, stay away from it, and haram. Prohibited completely. Okay? So if one person now is, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, la taqrabu as-salata wa antum sukara hatta ta'lamu ma taqulun. Allah says, oh you who believe, don't come near the prayer whilst you're intoxicated until you know what you're saying, unless you know what you're saying, and so on. One may say, khalas, Allah saying to me, I can drink, yani, just don't drink, it's salah time. Huh? La, it's abrogated. That ruling is no longer valid. It's gone. Huh? That's nasikh. So knowing the nasikh and mansukh, how do you know which ayah is abrogated and what abrogated it? It is by knowing what order they're revealed in, which came first and what came later. Right? Because if an ayah is saying something that contradicts the previous ayah, then that shows that this is abrogating the previous ayah and it came later. Right? Now, it's abrogating it. That's the first type. And also to know the muhkam and the mutashabih. The Quran, it has muhkam and mutashabih. Muhkam are the clear cut ayat. And that's the majority of the Quran, by the way. The majority of the Quran is clear. If I say to you, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, say that Allah is one. Can you interpret قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ in any other way? That Allah is one, can you say to me, no, that means that Allah is one and two and three and four. Insanity, right? It's clear, it's only one way of interpreting it, right? That's muhkam. And that's the majority of the Quran. But Allah says to you, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. Verily, we revealed the Quran, and we shall preserve it. Now, one may read that and say, it says we, does that mean there's more than one God? He may interpret it as it means more than one God. There's some ambiguity there. right? How do we deal with the ambiguity in the Quran? We refer it back to the muhkam, the clear-cut ayat. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ is there. So what is this inna, this we mean? It's the royal we, the majestic we. That Allah is referring to him as we to show his greatness and his glory, جَلَّ فِي عُلَى. That's all it is. Does that make sense? Na'am, that's muhkam mutashabih. Right, following the ambiguous ayat of the Quran is haram. Allah says, those who have deviation in their hearts, Allah says, Surah Al-Imran, they are the ones who look for the ambiguous verse and they follow it. They look for a way to interpret it in a misguided way to follow it. But the principle is that the ambiguous verses will refer back to the clear-cut verses. And then we have the halal and haram in the Quran, right? And that's pretty straightforward. What Allah made lawful, what Allah made unlawful is part of the knowledge of the Quran. And the amthal, the parables of the Quran. Allah mentioned in the Quran parables. He gives those examples for us to understand. Allah says, for instance, ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا. Allah has given a parable. لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, for those who disbelieve. Who are the examples that Allah has given the parable? إِمْرَأَةَ نُوحٍ وَإِمْرَأَةَ لُوطٍ. The wife of Nuh alayhi salam and Lut. They were the wives of righteous men, but they're disbelievers. They both didn't believe. And then Allah tells us, وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا امْرَأَةَ فِرْعَوْنَ. And Allah has given a parable for those who believe, the wife Fir'aun. Her husband is a tyrant who claimed lordship, but she believed. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, وَتِلْكَ الْأَمْثَالُ نَضْرِبُهَا لِلنَّاسِ وَمَا يَعْقِلُهَا إِلَّا الْعَالِمُ. The Salaf rahmatullah alayhim, some of them, when they recite this ayah, they will cry. Allah says, and these are the parables that we give to mankind. And then Allah says, وَمَا يَعْقِلُهَا إِلَّا الْعَالِمُونَ. Only those who possess knowledge are those who comprehend them. The Salaf, when they cry, they will cry when they recite this ayah, because they would say to themselves, if I did not understand a parable in the Quran, then that means that Allah Azza wa Jalla has not granted me beneficial knowledge. If I did not comprehend a parable of the Quran, then I have not been granted beneficial knowledge. They would cry over their state. How many parables in the Quran that we have no idea exist, huh? Now, that is part of the knowledge of the Quran. So all of this, when the person knows the Quran like that, it will give him wisdom. That's where he gets wisdom from. That's the point. Wisdom is in the wisdom of the Quran. And then we add to that something else. Allah says in the Quran, وَذْكُرْنَ مَا يُتْلَى فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ لَطِيفًا خَبِيرًا. Remember, O wives of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that which is being recited in your homes, min ayatillah, from the verses of Allah Azza wa Jalla, the Quran, wal hikmah, and wisdom. Wisdom here is the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So that's also where we seek wisdom from. The more you know the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and his guidance, and his seerah, and his example, you will be wise, because the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was the most wise amongst the creation. So you will learn wisdom from him. So wisdom, it is attained in two ways. Number one, it is through knowledge of the Quran, the Sunnah. And number two, it is through wisdom, it is through experience. And the greater out of the two it is, which gives you a shortcut, it is through knowledge. Because one may not live long enough to experience everything, to attain that wisdom. But with knowledge, you'll be granted that wisdom from Allah Azza wa Jal. That is Al-Hakim Jalla Fi'ula. The next name, the 31st name, Al-Azim, the greatest, the most great. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he says, وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ. That Allah is Al-Ali, the most high, Al-Azim, the most great. Al-Azim is an adjective. The most great is an adjective describing Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, his greatness. Right, an honor and pride of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. And it also shows, Azim, greatness, shows how high Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is. the high, His Highness Jalla fi Ula. And Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهُ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ, that they do not venerate Allah the way He deserves to be venerated. Why? Allah mentions after that, وَالْأَرْضُ جَمِيعًا قَبَضَتُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ مَطْوِيَّاتٌ بِيَمِينِهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. Allah says that they do not venerate Allah as He deserves to be venerated. وَالْأَرْضُ جَمِيعًا قَبَضَتُهُ, and all of the earth is in His palm. وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ, and the heavens, مَطْوِيَّاتٌ, they are folded بِيَمِينِهِ, in His right. Showing the greatness of Allah Ta'ala. سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. We have what Abdullah ibn the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he says. Now look at this. He says, مَا السَّمَاوَاتُ السَّبْعُ فِي الْكُرْسِي إِلَّا كَحَلْقَةٍ بِأَرْضِ فُلَاهُ وَفَضْلُ الْعَرْشِ عَلَى الْكُرْسِي كَفَضْلِ تِلْكَ الْفُلَاهُ وَالْفُلَاهُ عَلَى تِلْكَ الْحَلَقَةِ. He said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, that the seven heavens, they are in comparison to the kursi, the footstool of Allah تبارك وتعالى, a ring in an empty land. Imagine the desert, a ring in the desert, would it affect in any way? A small ring in the desert, nothing, right? And that's how small it is compared to the kursi, the footstool of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And then he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the footstool in comparison to the greatness of the arsh, the throne of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, it is the same, like a ring in an empty land. That's how small the kursi is compared to the arsh, throne of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. If that's how the creation of Allah Azza wa Jalla is, imagine Allah Jalla fi Ula, the greatness of Allah. Azamatullah. Naam. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala tells us in the Quran that when you venerate Allah and Allah's greatness is in your heart, it will affect the outcomes in your life. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يُكَفِّرْ عَنْهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِ وَيُعْظِمْ لَهُ أَجْرًا. The one who fears Allah, who venerates Allah, who is conscious of Allah, Allah will forgive his sins and expiate his sins, وَيُعْظِمْ لَهُ أَجْرًا, and he will make his reward great. You made Allah great in your heart, Allah will make your reward great. وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام says in the hadith, من سره أن يعظم الله رزقه وأن يمد في أجله فليصل رحمه. He said عليه الصلاة والسلام, whoever wants Allah تبارك وتعالى to make great for him his rizq, his provision, and to lengthen his lifespan for him, let him keep ties with his kin. Allah mentions the wording يُعْظِم, and that's one of the meanings of Al-Azim, the great one, that he makes great your deeds, your reward, and your rizq, and so on. He's the one who makes those matters great for you, that it will be heavy on your scale يوم القيامة, to be great in the sight of Allah جَلَّ فِي عُلَاهِ. طيب, Allah عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, he mentions his name Al-Azim with other names in the Quran, Al-Alim, we mentioned early on, the Most High Al-Azim. And it shows that Al-Aliyu Al-Azim, that Allah is the greatest and the Most High. He mentioned the Most High before His greatness Jalla fi Ula, to show you and to indicate that He is the Most Great, who is the Most High, the Highest Jalla fi Ula, above all His creation with His greatness. He's above all imperfection and everything that negates His greatness. And we have in the hadith of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, which shows the greatness of Allah تبارك وتعالى, he says, إن الله يمسك السماوات على إصبع والأرضين على إصبع والجبال والشجر على إصبع والماء والثرى على إصبع وسائر الخلق على إصبع ثم يهزهن فيقول أنا الملك. That Allah تبارك وتعالى يمسكوا. He holds السماوات, the heavens, with one finger, and all of the earths with one finger, and the mountains and the trees with one finger, and the water and the seas and so on, and the soil and so on with one finger, and the rest of the creation with one finger. And then Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He shakes them and He says, Ana al-Malik, I am the King. If that's how Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He is with His creation, imagine the greatness of Allah Azza wa Jal. وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدَرِهِ. They did not venerate Allah Azza wa Jal as He deserves to be venerated, as Allah says. What is the effect that this name is meant to have upon us? Al-Azim. When the believer, he knows that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is Al-Azim, the greatest. And that greatness of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is in his heart. And it's on his tongue, he's uttering it. And it's evident on his limbs. He must be truthful in that by venerating Allah, by obeying him and not disobeying him. Because truly venerating Allah Azza wa Jalla, it is by obeying him and not disobeying him, number one. And to remember him and not to forget him. And to be grateful to him and not to be ungrateful. And nothing is too great for Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. So you ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala for everything. That is you truly venerating Allah. That is Al-Azim. We have the next name, Al-Qawi. Today we're going to go through a lot, by the way. We need to speed up. Al-Qawi. What does Al-Qawi mean? Huh? What does Al-Qawi mean? Huh? It comes from strength, quwwa. The strongest, the most strong. وهو القوي العزيز, Allah says. Allah says in Surah Al-Shura, الله لطيف بعباده يرزق من يشاء وهو القوي العزيز. الله لطيف بعباده. Look at this, يا عبادي. الله لطيف بعباده. Allah is subtle, this lace. Subtle. يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. He provides whoever he wishes. وَهُوَ الْقَوِيُّ الْعَزِيزُ. And he is the strongest, the almighty. The beginning of the ayah, what did they say? Allah is subtle, these slaves. But don't think that Allah being subtle means that it is out of weakness. وَهُوَ الْقَوِيُّ الْعَزِيزُ. The almighty, the almighty, and the strongest. Also from his subtleness, جل في علاه, because the lutf, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, from his subtleness, it is that in certain places there is quwwah, there is strength. Because Allah says, يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. He provides for whoever he wishes. So why did he say, هُوَ الْقَوِيلَ عَزِيهِ, he's the most strongest, meaning that no one can prevent the provision of Allah determines for someone. No one's strong enough to prevent it. Allah is the strongest. When he spoke about Jalla fi ula, about rizq, in another ayah, Allah said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. Allah is الرَّزَّاق, the one, the sustainer. ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ, the one who possesses the strongest strength. The severest strength. Why did he mention strength after rizq? Because Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is telling us that He is the one who grants you rizq, and no one is strong enough to prevent it from it coming your way, no matter who they are. The biggest king in the world, he doesn't have the strength to prevent it. That's from the lutf, the subtleness of Allah. Allahu latifun bi'ibadihi yarzuqu man yasha. But something else. Notice that Allah said, Allahu Latifun, Allah is subtle with his slaves, not his creation. Latif with his slaves. You attain the subtleness of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala through what? Servitude. You attain the protection of Allah with quwwa through servitude. Alaysa Allahu bikafin 'abda? Isn't Allah Azza wa Jalla sufficient for who? Does Allah suffice who? His slave. Through servitude, Allah will suffice you, meaning protect you. طيب القوة in Arabic it means the opposite of ضعف, weakness, يعني strength and being incapable, right? And the religious meaning of al-qawi, right? The strongest. It is that Allah Azza wa Jalla has the ultimate strength, the most strength, which has no weakness at all ever. And nothing can overpower the strength of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And all other strength, it is minor in front of the strength of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Nothing. طيب, Allah mentions in the Quran, I mentioned this already, so we'll skip it, but he mentions another ayah, وَلِيَعْلَمَ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ وَرُسُلَهُ بِالْغَيْبِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ. Allah says in Surah Hadid, Allah Azza wa Jalla, he wants to know those who are going to grant victory to him, aid Allah and his messenger. إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ. Verily Allah is قَوِيٌّ, the strongest, Aziz, the Almighty. Now, Allah ended the ayah after saying that Allah wants to know who those amongst us who are going to grant victory to Allah and His Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah ended it that He's Almighty and strongest to dismiss from our minds that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is saying that He needs us and He needs our strength and us to grant victory to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Rather, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, He is saying to us that He wants us to aid the religion of Allah and Allah and so on by doing what Allah commanded, to stay away from the prohibitions of Allah and follow the sunnah of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam and defending it and so on. That is to benefit us, not to benefit Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah ended with, He's Qawi, He's Aziz. Rather, He ended with that to show that He's the one who's going to grant you victory if you do that. وَلَيَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَقَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ. Verily Allah, He grants strength to those, and He grants victory to those who grant victory to Allah. Meaning they follow the commandments of Allah, they stay away from the prohibitions of Allah, they are ones who live by the command of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. They do that, Allah Azza will grant the victory. Inna Allah qawi la qawiyyun aziz. Allah is the strongest, as He is Almighty. He is the one who grants victory in aid to His awliya, His allies. That's what it means. Is to dismiss the idea of anyone thinking that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is in need of us. La kalla. It is rather for us to benefit from that. By responding to that call, Allah wants us to benefit and to get the victory of Allah and the strength of Allah Azza wa Jalla, the might of Allah on our side. طيب. We find that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, He mentions in the Quran about nations that were destroyed. Specifically, Ad. Ad, what did they think? They were people of Hud alayhi salam. They were people who were very strong physically. Allah says in Surah Fussilat, فَأَمَّا عَادٌ فَاسْتَكْبَرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ أَسْفَ عَادٌ. They became arrogant on the earth. بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ, without any right. وَقَالُوا مَنْ أَشَدُّ مِنَّا قُوَّةٌ. And they said, who is stronger than us? أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا أَنَّ اللَّهَ الَّذِي خَلَقَهُمْ هُوَ أَشَدُّ مِنْهُمْ قُوَّةٌ. Do they not see that Allah Azza wa Jalla, the one who created them, He is stronger than them? So because of that arrogance that they had, Allah Tabaraka destroyed them. What did Allah destroy them with? Who knows? Rih, the wind. The wind destroyed these people. Strong. The wind came, completely wiped them out. Allah mentions Surah Al-Ahqaf. And he mentioned many places how they're destroyed. فَلَمَّا رَأَوْهُ عَارِضًا مُسْتَقْبِلَ أَوْدِيَتِهِمْ قَالُوا هَذَا عَارِضٌ مُمْطِرُنَا بَلْ هُمَا اسْتَعْجَلْتُمْ بِهِ رِيحٌ فِيهَا عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ تُدَمِّرُ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ بِأَمْرِ رَبِّهَا فَأَصْبَحُوا لَا يُرَى إِلَّا مَسَاكِنُهُمْ. Allah says, when they saw it, the wind that is coming their way, they said, this is عارض, this is something that's coming, they give us rain. And they were told, لَا بَلْ هُمَا اسْتَعْجَلْتُمْ بِهِ. It is what you asked for, to be hastened, the punishment of Allah. رِيحٌ, it is wind, فِيهَا عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ, in it is عَذَابُ ice, painful punishment. What is this wind going to do? تُدَمِّرُ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ بِأَمْرِ رَبِّهَا, is going to destroy everything with the command of Allah. فَأَصْبَحُوا لَا يُرَى إِلَّا مَسَاكِنُهُمْ. What happened? They were completely destroyed. The only thing that could be seen was their homes. كَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي الْقَوْمَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ. Like that, Allah says, we reward the criminals. Because what did they say to Hud alayhi salam? Tell your Lord to bring the punishment that you talk about so much. Let us see it. They asked for it, it came to them. Rih. Allah says, وَفِي عَادٍ إِذْ أَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمُ الرِّيحَ الْعَقِيمِ مَا تَذَرُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ أَتَتْ عَلَيْهِ إِلَّا جَعَلَتُ كَالرَّمِيمِ. Allah says, نعاد. وَفِي عَادٍ إِذْ أَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ, when we sent to them الرِّيحَ الْعَقِيمِ, the wind that's the عَقِيمِ, destroys everything, leaves nothing, destroys them all, يعني. مَا تَذَرُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ, doesn't leave anything, إِلَّا جَعَلَتُ كَالرَّمِيمِ, not to be found, خلاص, no trace of it, that's what it did. What is the effect of this name, Al-Qawi? Isn't it common that we sometimes will fear an individual or a group of people due to us assuming that they have a lot of strength? So we fear them. And it perhaps stops us from doing certain things. But when we know that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is Al-Qawi, the strongest, and we know إِنَّ بَطَشَ رَبِّكَ لَشَدِيدٌ, that the striking of your Lord, it is severe. Allah strikes you, خلاص. That should always remind us that there's nothing else to be feared except Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. Whenever I fail like that, I remember Allah. So what does it do? It makes you one who is strong in the obedience of Allah. It makes you one who is strong in enjoining good. It makes you one who is strong in forbidding evil. And it also makes you one who does not fear anyone to utter the truth. That's when you know Allah is qawi. That's the effect that it has on you. Because the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said in hadith, المؤمن القوي خير وأحب إلى الله من المؤمن الضعيف. That the believer who is strong, the stronger believer, he is better and more beloved to Allah than the weak believer. The strength that's referred to here, it is strength in the obedience of Allah, strength in doing what Allah has commanded, strength upon the haqq, and being one who is strong when it comes to the truth. That is strength that's referred to. Because physical strength comes from that too, by the way. It comes from the strength of ibadah and ta'ah. And to increase la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, as we mentioned earlier on. Because kanzu min kunuz al-jannah is a treasure from the treasures of paradise. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Whenever you say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, you know what it means? Literally, it means a translation, there's no might and power except to Allah. But it means that you are freeing yourself from your power and your strength and your might, and you're fleeing to the power and the strength and the might of Allah. You're seeking from Allah. That's what it means. When you do that, and when you say that, Allah will grant you it from your heart. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله كنز من كنوز الجنة. طيب, The next name, As-Sami'. We're going to think the last two names, As-Sami' and Basir, inshallah. And we'll conclude with that, inshallah. As-Sami', the all-hearing. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says in the Quran, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Allah Azza wa Jalla, nothing is like him. And he's As-Sami', the all-hearing, Al-Basir, the all-seeing. What does As-Sami' mean religiously? It means that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, there's no one who hears more than him and better than him. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he hears everything that is to be heard, regardless of language, regardless of that which is hidden and that which is apparent. Allah even hears that which is hidden. That which is not even made apparent, Allah hears it. That which is far and close, Allah hears it all. Jalla fi ula. Allah hears the call of those who are in dire need. He hears the dua of those who are in need. He hears the complaint of those who've been oppressed. Allah, whilst he's above his throne, Jalla fi ula, above his creation, above the heavens, Jalla fi ula, he hears all of that. He hears that which you think in your mind. That which crosses your mind, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he hears it. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he hears the whispers of your soul to you. He hears it, Jalla fi ula. He hears that which your soul conceals, Jalla fi ula. He hears it all. Nothing is hidden from him. And the hearing of Allah Azza wa Jal, it is two types. The first type, it is that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he hears the sounds of everything. Those that are apparent sounds and the hidden sounds. Right? And all the sounds, no matter how many they are in number and how different they are, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala hears them as if they are one sound. Jalla fi ula. That's the first type of hearing. The second type of hearing, it is that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he hears in order to respond to the call of those who call upon him. Like Allah says in the Quran, Inna Rabbi lasami'u dua. Like Ibrahim said, verily my Lord, he hears the dua, meaning he responds to the dua, he hears it to respond to the dua. Responsive. And we find the Quran that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he says, Innahu huwa sami'ul alim, that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he's a sami', the all hearing, al alim, the all knowing. And this teaches us something, that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he is the one who hears everything and he has the knowledge of everything. Because one may hear something and may not understand it. The creation, right? They may hear something, they may not know it. But Allah hears it and he knows it. It shows perfection in hearing. You hear it and you know it. And Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he also says in the Quran, إِنَّهُ سَمِيعٌ قَرِيبٌ, that verily Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he's all-hearing the near, right? Meaning that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he hears as if you are near to him, everything. And Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he is close to you with his knowledge. So he's hearing everything that is occurring. وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ وَنَعْلَمُ مَا تُوَسْوِسُ بِهِ نَفْسُهُ, that Allah says, we have created man and we know what his soul whispers to him. وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبِّ الْوَرِيدِ, and we are closer to him than the jugular vein. Meaning Allah is extremely close to you with his knowledge, جَلَّ فِي عُلَى, and his muraqabah. طيب. What is the effect that this name is meant to have upon us? We're going to mention that at the end. After we mention Al-Basir, the next name, because we're going to do them together. Al-Basir, the all-seeing. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. Fear Allah Azza wa Jalla, and know that Allah Azza wa Jalla, he is the all-seeing of what you do. Al-Basir is the one who sees everything. Right? No one sees more than Allah. لَا أَبْصَرَ مِنْهُ. Everything, Allah Azza wa Jalla, he sees it. He is the one who, he sees the ant, دبيب النملة السوداء تحت الصخرة الصماء في ليلة الظلماء. He sees the ant that is walking under a huge rock in a dark night. Allah sees it. Everything Allah Azza wa Jalla, he sees it. لا تخفى عليه خافية. The hidden matters are not hidden from Allah. Nothing is hidden from Allah Azza wa Jalla. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, he mentions, لَيْسَ كَمِذْلِهِ شَيْءٌ لَكَ مَشْءَ الْيَوْمِ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Nothing is like Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, and he is a Sami', al-basir, the all-hearing and the all-seeing. And this, what it should do is, now let's give you an example. Lillahi al-mathal al-a'la. There are cameras here, isn't it? When you go to certain places, there are CCTV cameras. The CCTV cameras, they don't record audio, do they? They record only the footage, right? So when the CCTV, it records you doing a certain way, something which may look wrong, you could have done something wrong, but you could deny it. You could say, I didn't say that. He didn't hear what I said, the audio. But Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, His muraqaba of you. You see CCTV, you do not do anything wrong, because you see camera, people are going to see what I did. Right? You are shy of what people may see. They may play back the footage and say, oh, he did this. So you behave in front of the camera. But Allah Azza wa Jalla sees you at all times, and does not only see you, but also hears you. Nothing is hidden from Allah. Any perfection in the muraqaba that Allah does of you, that Allah is aware of you, and is with the ilm, knowledge. خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. Allah is aware of what you do. سَمِيعٌ بَصِيرٌ. He's the all-hearing, the all-seeing. Sees it, he knows it, he is aware of it. جَلَّ فِي عُلَى. What that should do is that it should make one extremely conscious of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. And knowing these two names, it is what gets you to the level of ihsan. وَشَبِينَ اللَّهُ الْإِحْسَانِ. Because ihsan, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he defined it. And he said, it is أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراك. To worship Allah as if you can see Allah. And if you cannot see Allah Azza wa Jal, you know that Allah, you're aware and conscious that Allah can see you. So ihsan has two levels. مشاهدة and مراقبة. Two levels. مشاهدة and مراقبة. مشاهدة, it is the higher level, which is that you worship Allah as if you can see Allah. And then the second level is مراقبة, that you're conscious that Allah can see you. And this is the level that every believer must have, by the way. He must have مراقبة, conscious, being conscious of Allah. If you don't have that, then the iman that you claim, something's wrong with it. طيب. That is the effect that these two names are meant to have upon us. As-Sami' and Al-Basir. And with that, we're going to stop here, inshaAllah ta'ala, with these two names. And we're going to continue next lesson, inshaAllah ta'ala, from Al-Qahir and Al-Qahhar. InshaAllah tabarak wa ta'ala. Which is in 36 and 37. InshaAllah ta'ala. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to benefit us with what we heard. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to forgive our sins. We ask Allah Azza wa Ta'ala mercy upon us. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to make us from righteous slaves. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to make us from those who hear the speech and follow the best of it. We ask Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala to make us from those who implement these names in their lives, and that these names are evident in their lives. إنه ولي ذلك والقادر عليه وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والحمد لله رب العالمين.